Hey everyone, I hope you had a great day. The first story is called Not Exactly What They Meant. My first job was working for a locally owned grocery store. It was a pretty good first job, and most of the bosses weren't too bad. There was one I wasn't crazy about because he was a stickler and liked to micromanage. My job included stocking the shelves. We always had a routine when starting the day where we went through the aisles with a notepad. We wrote down what was needed and then we went to the back to load up a U-boat, those metal U-shaped frames with the required products to fill the shelves. One day a new rule was implemented. We were not allowed on the floor without a U-boat. Clearly, the idea was to increase efficiency by taking note of what was needed while simultaneously putting products on the shelves. However, the issue was the unwavering wording that we always needed a U-boat while on the floor. As most know, there are very few situations where things work well as always and never. The time comes for my first shift with the new rule. I clock in and I'm ready to work. Wait, I need to have a U-boat if I'm out on the floor. But I don't know what I need on the floor without checking first. This seems like an issue. It would be a waste of time to load up an entire U-boat with product that I may discover is completely full on the shelves. So me, who doesn't enjoy following rules or norms that do not make sense, grabs an empty U-boat and drags it around the entire store with me while taking note of what products we need. Just as I'm heading to the back with my U-boat, Supervisor Stiffly Stifferson walks up next to me and asks why my U-boat is empty. If I had loaded shelves, it would have had empty boxes and plastic on it. I tell him very matter-of-factly, well, I had to see what was needed on the shelves. And the rule says I always need a U-boat with me if I'm on the floor. I'm pretty positive I saw him trying to conceal a smirk as he informed me that was not exactly what they meant by the rule. The next story is called New Policy Compliance. I used to work a crappy retail job in LA and the boss had just hired a new assistant manager. Picture a blonde Karen who appears to be in her 40s but tells everyone she's 33. She was recently divorced from her Beverly Hills doctor or dentist husband and now has to actually work for the first time in her life to support herself and her 4 children. On her first week there, the super smart lady left her Louis Vuitton bag open on the break room table instead of locking it in her assigned locker. And someone stole $200 from her purse. Not saying it was her fault, it was definitely the thief's fault for taking something that didn't belong to them. But Karen's response to it was just stupid. Assistant manager Karen then told us that as a new policy, no one could enter the break room without her permission. This way she would know who was going in there and when, so that if anything else was stolen, she'd have a clear culprit. I'm not sure how she intended to enforce this during the times she wasn't in the store. But maybe it didn't matter if other people besides her got stolen from. For reference, this was the first theft any of us had seen since being at the company. I don't think they ever caught whoever it was that stole from her because we were too cheap to have security cameras in our break room. It was an old single room bathroom with the toilet ripped out and a table and locker put in. But part of me really wouldn't be surprised if Karen had misplaced the $200 herself, or had never had $200 to begin with. Well, we obviously didn't like Karen strutting into our workplace and trying to limit our access to our own break room, so cue malicious compliance. Every time our hands were sticky and we needed to wash them in the break room sink, we interrupted Karen. Every time we needed to take a drink of water, which we were only allowed to do in the break room, we interrupted Karen. Every time we needed to sweep something up, but the broom was in the break room, we interrupted Karen. Every time we had to throw something away, but the trash can was in the break room, we interrupted Karen. Every time we needed to restock a product that had a box of it sitting in the break room, we interrupted Karen. Karen could barely get her own inventories and paperwork done because of how often we needed her permission to open the break room door. She ended up getting so frustrated that the new policy lasted about 3 days and she quit soon after that. I now have a much better job that doesn't involve retail in the slightest. Which one is your favorite story of today's video? Please let me know in the comment section below. Thanks for all the comments and likes on the past videos. Please don't forget to hit the like button on today's video as well. The third story is called It Does Not Fit. This happened to my boss earlier this week and I was super impressed by her quick thinking. I work at a shop that sells a specific artisan food item in the UK. We are still open during quarantine because part of the business is online. So we either deliver local packages personally or get a national courier service to send parcels overnight. While we have the courier service come collect parcels every day, sometimes it's cheaper to go through the post office if delivery is in some weird place like the Scottish Islands or on one of the Isles. Anyway, my boss goes over to the post office to deliver one of the parcels. It's a cardboard box, which is almost a perfect cube, except it's a few centimeters higher than it's wide. The address is written along the side. Once there, the postal worker gets one of those plastic boards with parcel-shaped holes in it to test where the parcel can fit and therefore its size classification. And here's where things get weird. The postal worker classes the parcel way bigger than usual, doubling the postage price because it won't fit through the plastic cutout. My boss explains him that if he puts the parcel on its side, it fits perfectly. Apparently, that's not allowed. Postal workers couldn't possibly send the parcel on its side. If my boss wants to send it, she'll have to agree to pay the extra postage. End of discussion. Well, my boss has a trick up her sleeve, aka a Sharpie. She crosses out the address, flips the box on its side, and rewrites the address again. So the height of the box is now smaller than its wide. The same box is now classed as a smaller size. And we don't have to pay almost a tenner extra. Maybe not be loads, but the pandemic hasn't exactly been great for business. The next story is called Still Got Paid. I worked at a gear cutting factory for a few summers while studying at university. It was minimum wage and they just moved me about the place wherever I was needed. But it was easy work and kept me busy. I spent a few weeks working in the inspection department, learning to use tools that test the quality of gears that were cut. Usually, we just test a sample, and if every piece in the sample is within tolerance, then we move on. If some pieces are slightly out of the tolerance and others are okay, we might contact the customer and ask if they are acceptable at a discounted rate or something. In this case, however, we had a batch of about 1,000 tiny gears, each the size of a pea, that needed to be within a very strict tolerance. I tested 50 or so, and every piece was way out. The batch was ruined, no idea why. That was down to the gear cutters. But the bottom line was that someone made a mistake and they would have to be scrapped. I informed the senior inspectors about this. Normally they are lovely guys and I had nothing against them. But that day they were particularly stressed with their own work and didn't want to spend time coming up with different work for me. So they told me to check every single gear in case any of them were salvageable. So I spent the next 2 days manually testing every single gear in a batch of 1,000 and carefully noting the result in a spreadsheet. As expected, every single gear was faulty. Oh well, I still got paid. The last story is called Exactly What It Is Worth. My brother was renting a home. He was one of those long-term renters who stayed at the same location for over 10 years. He was moving out and the landlord was trying his best to get every penny out of him that he could. He looked around the house and tried to charge him for every little thing. Stains on the wall, the cupboard that was broken before he moved in, and so on. The biggest, most expensive offense was the carpet. The carpet was not pretty. Stains everywhere, a big hole where a cigarette was dropped, threads showing. The carpet was clearly old when he moved in, but he wasn't very prepared and didn't think to take pictures before he moved in. I devised a plan to help him out. I know the law pretty well and went with my brother to sign the final paperwork. I don't know why the landlord thought he could charge him beyond his deposit. Regardless, he was going to have to pay for all of the brand new carpets because of the one hole he caused. So the landlord smugly pulled out the paperwork to have him sign. I took one look at it, smirked and told him to sign it. They got done with all of it, shook hands, and the landlord started bragging about how much he was going to make off of him. Then I dropped the bomb. The paper said that my brother had to reimburse the landlord for what the carpet was worth. According to the law that I had a copy of in my pocket, carpets are worthless after 10 years of use, which my brother alone fit as qualification. The landlord was flabbergasted. Apparently, he ended up just using some leftover carpet that he had in storage to replace the square where the cigarette burn was located, instead of replacing the whole carpet. Thanks for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please leave a like, comment, and subscribe for more content. Have a great day and stay safe. Bye bye.